The saying goes, the more things change, the more they stay the same. And when we talk about Santa Monica, those words couldn't be more true. And that's a good thing, because it means that no matter how the face of the city has changed, its soul has remained constant, a tranquil little beach town by the bay. I'm Daniel Farias, and I'm your host for this year's Boards and Commissions Report. I'm here at the iconic Santa Monica Pier because it not only provides a very picturesque background for these little interludes, but it's also the perfect analogy for this year's theme, a celebration of timeless community service. I mean, after all, the pier has been here almost as long as the city itself, and like the city, it's seen its fair share of ups and downs throughout the decades. But it's still standing, and its future looks very bright indeed. To fully appreciate the pier today, you have to look at its history. Take this place for example, the Santa Monica Loop Hippodrome. Since 1916, this place and the carousel that it houses has entertained millions of people as one of the original structures on the Pleasure Pier Amusement Park, which made Santa Monica the place to be in the 1920s. Through the efforts of people who worked to protect history and preserve this place, the Hippodrome is still here today to enjoy and visit. Now, let's take a look at some groups who've made it their business to protect and preserve Santa Monica's history and unique character.
The Santa Monica Library is celebrating its 125th anniversary this year, and so we come to you from the Ocean Park branch, which was built in 1918.
The Santa Monica Public Library has continued to be a wonderful resource for the community during the past year. We celebrated the grand opening of our newest branch in the Pico neighborhood in June. In recognition of its exceptional design and sustainability, it won a 2014 Merit Award for Architecture from the American Institute of Architects California Council, and it has been warmly embraced by the community. We welcomed Maria Carpenter as our new Director of Services. Our 2014 Summer Reads program was the biggest ever with over 4,700 participants. We added new digital programs, and library patrons now have access to magazines through Xenio and to movies with Hoopla. Santa Monica Reads continues to grow, and this year residents enjoyed learning about Regency England when we read Longbourn by Joe Baker. In May, we will introduce a new event, the How To Festival, with dozens of local residents sharing their skills at all branches of the library. In April, we hosted for the first time Y'all West, the West Coast edition of a young adult book festival, with dozens of authors appearing at the library and the high school. We hope to see you at the events that will mark our 125 years of engagement with the city. Check us out.
The Arts Commission is an 11-member commission that advises the City Council on matters of policy, provides support and services to Santa Monica's individual artists and nonprofit organizations, and works to increase community engagement in the arts by facilitating public art installations and encouraging the presence of art galleries, museums, theaters, and performance spaces. In 2014, the commission oversaw the installation of two new bike racks on Ocean Park Boulevard as the public art element of the Ocean Park Green Street project. Another new artwork, Exuberant Birds, was installed at three intersections of Longfellow Street as part of the Longfellow Sustainable Street Project. The first season of new cultural programming launched at Tongva Park, Family Saturdays, which offered interactive fun for all ages, and Tongva After Dark, which invited residents to experience the park in a whole new light through various eclectic performances and events. To support working artists in Santa Monica, 10 units in the new Belmar apartment building were uniquely designed as artist studio units, the first affordable live-work studios in the city. To further that goal, the Arts Commission adopted the Arts and Urban Fabric Committee's White Paper, a document that works to protect and ensure new live-work opportunities for artists as the city continues to develop and grow. Following the official closure of the Santa Monica Civic Auditorium in the summer of 2013, the City Council appointed the Civic Working Group in October of that same year to research and present options to the Council for the future cultural and community use of the structure and the surrounding area. The 9-member group has been very active in its duties and its inclusion of public input during its research, offering a cutting-edge online tool for the community to consider the financial and operational trade-offs of various development scenarios. In addition, they conducted two very successful community workshops in September 2014 and January 2015, with the participation of over 1,800 people who were welcomed to share their preferences, ideas, and concerns. A third workshop is planned for June 13th of this year. Titled Bringing It All Together, the Civic Working Group will again engage the community for their input on the preliminary recommendations to Council to be revised, finalized, and officially presented this fall.
. 2014 brought us new faces and new tasks. Members Pamela Burton and John Ellis departed mid-year, and in the fall we welcomed two exceptional architects, Therese Kelly and Patrick Tai. We tackled a steady rise in the number of project reviews, and doing our part to advance the Luce, we shared input on the zoning ordinance update and are continuing to review the draft zoning ordinance design guidelines. But looking back, the work that stands apart are the float-up and concept reviews. This newly instated practice of viewing high-impact projects much earlier than before is a dynamic change. It provides the board an opportunity to weigh in long before development agreements are finalized. The protocol has a unique and welcome give and take. We examine and respond to design concepts, materials, programming, massing, and context, among many other details of these complex applications. It's an engaging process, and it underscores our mission to preserve Santa Monica's reputation as a place of beauty, spaciousness, and quality, while making the most of the expertise and insight that our board has to offer.
In World War II caused a massive decline in business for the attractions at the Pleasure Pier. But the city was steadfast, and in 1941, a new identity for the pier was forever sealed with the installation of the world-famous Santa Monica Pier sign. It was the era of boating at the pier. When the war had ended, thousands of soldiers returning home were looking for some well-earned recreation. And with all the new attention to the pier, came new interest in developing it. Enter Walter Newcomb, who purchased the Pleasure Pier in 1943, renamed it the Newcomb Pier, and sought out to reestablish the pier's amusement routes to delight yet another generation of Santa Monica's residents and visitors. Investing in Santa Monica's residents and visitors. Now, that sounds like something these next groups are particularly good at.
Tongva Park became a treasure destination in Santa Monica over the past year, and now we're thrilled to develop another new park at the corner of Exposition and Stewart Street. An oasis of tranquility to shield local residents from the impact of Expo. In 2014, we were especially gratified by the success of the Pilot Fitness Trainers program, and we look forward to similar safety enhancements to our parks with the recent ban on exotic animals. We also reviewed and provided input on important projects such as the Memorial Park Neighborhood Draft Plan, the bike sharing program, as well as parks and beach capital improvement proposals. Renovations to Ozone Park will include safety enhancements and a gift from the Kiwanis Club to modernize the East Playground will round out the improvements at Ozone. And a community design process will begin for a new playground at North Beach. Looking to the future, commissioners have a keen interest in renovating the grass area at Reed Park. Community outreach is in full swing to find out what amenities residents want. Our commission continues to seek out new opportunities from innovative parklets and parks. We're working to provide needed green space in our densely populated city. Every day, a robust program of arts, sports, and leisure activities allows our citizens to exercise, explore their creativity, learn new skills, and be active. It's time you spent more time at Santa Monica's parks and beaches. We'll see you soon in one of our parks.
Welcome to the Santa Monica Airport. This past year, the Airport Commission closely monitored the Measure LC and Measure D ballot initiatives. Upon the victory of Measure LC for parks and playing fields, the Airport Commission continued to guide the City Council through the historic expiration of the 1984 Santa Monica Airport Agreement, which expires on July 1st, 2015. To that end, the Airport Commission recommended an environmental ordinance and leasing policy to make the airport more compatible with the surrounding residential uses and to improve the quality of life. The Airport Commission also recommended a fiscal policy to ensure the financial stability of the airport and to convert all leases to month-to-month tenancies to allow for the maximum planning flexibility under the Measure LC mandate. We look forward to the historic actions to be taken by the City Council to continue to make the airport a more compatible neighbor while the City Council and residents decide its fate.
Santa Monica is a great community for those who benefit from our affordable housing programs and policies. There are excellent supportive social services, libraries, parks, schools, and transit, and our strong economy provides jobs for local residents. This dynamic is happening right now at High Place East. High Place East is comprised of 44 affordable three-bedroom units for families earning up to 60% of the area median income. Its proximity to transit, schools, and local jobs allows families to provide a better future for their children. Affordable housing doesn't just provide a roof over one's head, but it also provides access to many of the opportunities that Santa Monica has to offer. This past year, the Housing Commission provided input on the downtown specific plan, made recommendations on minimum occupancy standards, and advised the City Council to give preference to disabled persons when fully accessible units became available. We count on your support to ensure Santa Monica remains a community of great diversity and opportunity.
I'm Christopher Walton, Chair of the Santa Monica Rent Control Board. I'm here in the City Hall Council Chambers, where the board meets to do the people's business. Last year, we held several public meetings to discuss the board's budget, to consider changes to regulations, and to announce the annual general adjustment. The board also developed and recommended to the City Council a ballot proposal to establish a maximum annual registration fee to fund the board's operations. Voters approved Measure FS, and beginning in 2015, owners are able to pass through just 50% of the annual fee to tenants. As our name suggests, the Rent Control Board's primary purpose is to control rents. And sometimes, landlords and tenants disagree about what the controlled amount of a unit's rent really is or should be. When that happens, we hold a hearing before an impartial hearing officer to decide the issue. Last year, our hearing officers held 66 hearings. Of those, only 9 were appealed to the board. That's a pretty high satisfaction rate. Last year, our staff met with 2,527 people at our public counter, took over 9,000 calls, and responded to almost 700 email inquiries. And we don't just wait for the public to come to us. We also send out 2 newsletters a year to landlords and tenants of every rent-controlled unit in the city. We hold 4 seminars a year, in addition to attending various community meetings. This has been just a fraction of what we do to administer the rent control law. To find out more, visit our website, call us, or visit our City Hall office. And of course, come to the board's public meetings. I hope to see you there.
In the 1960s, the popularity of the pier was slipping again. This time due to the rapid development of inland attractions. Shopping malls, movie theaters, and more sophisticated amusement parks like Disneyland pulled attention away from the pier as a place to visit for a day's entertainment. With the pier's future looking bleak, the official decision was made to tear it down. But if the 60s were anything, they were the years of power to the people. And in that spirit, a citizen-based group called Save Santa Monica Bay rallied together to protect and preserve the pier. Their efforts were successful, and in 1973, the City Council's standing order to demolish the pier was revoked, with an additional proposition passed in 1975 to preserve the pier in perpetuity. These next groups carry on that same sentiment of by the people, for the people, with the compassionate work that they do. Let's take a look.
Hi, I'm Nancy Link Ellis, and I'm here to tell you about what the Disability Commission has done this year. Not only did we support programs for residents in need of services, we also did some education and outreach. We held an Animals Helping People event to teach the community about service animals. Santa Monica Police and Animal Control officers participated along with some adorable puppies for adoption. Our Mental Health Awareness event, coming up on May 16, will examine people in recovery from mental illness and substance abuse with a film and panel discussion. Also this month on May 30th, we're co-sponsoring Life Rolls On, an international surfing event that puts surfers with acquired disabilities from injury back on a board and with the help of local surfers take the waves. We want visitors and residents alike to have fun while we promote the city's considerable efforts to include everyone on our world-renowned beaches. This year we will celebrate the 25th anniversary of the Americans with Disabilities Act by continuing to work on behalf of people with disabilities to make this a city to live, work, and play. Stay tuned.
The mission of the Social Services Commission is simple: preserve and enhance the quality of life for all of Santa Monica's residents. Through ongoing dialogue, outreach, education, and advocacy, the 9-member commission advises and assists the City Council and staff with needs assessment, priorities, planning, and budgetary implications for social service programs. Highlights in 2014 included a public hearing to identify and discuss social service priorities and goals to inform the new 5-year consolidated plan that determines use of funds received from the Department of Housing and Urban Development. The Commission provided input on the Santa Monica Cradle to Career Initiative's 2014 Youth Well-Being Report Card, Kindergarten Readiness Campaign, and Youth Resource Team 2.0. And lastly, the Santa Monica Homeless Count was again successfully conducted in January with the support of city staff and over 250 community volunteers. The findings were revealed at a public meeting held in February. This year, the Commission is enhancing its focus on public education and the interface of law enforcement and homeless individuals, and are actively exploring partnerships with local businesses to assist in fundraising efforts for homeless services, as well as the development of a positive public education campaign around homelessness in our community. The Commission for the Senior Community advises the City Council and City Management on issues that affect older adults. When members of the community complained that the new bus stop seats gave them a pain, the Commission sat down with the Big Blue Bus and put their back into developing adaptive seats that work better for seniors and people with disabilities. This year, the Commission has been focused on getting the word out to seniors about services they should look for and scams they should look out for. The Commission sponsored a new West Side Resource Directory where older adults and their families can find all the services they need. Did you know there are endless schemes to trick you out of your money? The IRS scam, the granny scam, the Medicare scam, and so on. The Commission knows, and they've partnered with Assemblymember Richard Bloom on a Scam Stoppers event in November. They've also co-produced a DVD about scams to educate folks in their homes who may be at the most risk. Come to the Commission's table at the Santa Monica Festival to pick up a copy of the DVD and the West Side Guide for the seniors in your life.
My name is Rebecca Lantry, and I am the Vice Chair of the Commission on the Status of Women. Our Commission's purpose is to enhance the status of women in our community through investigation of, advocacy for, and policy development addressing issues relevant to women and girls, and creating leadership and career advancement opportunities for women and girls in our community.
During the 2014-2015 year, the 9 commissioners fostered civic engagement and sense of community within Santa Monica by having our 4th annual Women's History Month.
Commissioners participated in the Santa Monica Festival and the Well-Being Festival as outreach to the public and to gain input of what women and girls want.
We took a more active role with the Association of California Commission on Women. Our Vice Chair Lantry is now the co-chair of sponsorships for the 100th year anniversary of ACCW in 2016.
We delivered our Santa Monica Commission on the Status of Women report on the status of women and girls in the city of Santa Monica in 2015.
Commissioners, in partnership with Santa Monica Police Department, adopted the Start by Believing public awareness campaign to raise awareness on the public response to domestic violence.
Finally, the Commission is looking forward to our new year of activities, and to get the current updates, we urge you to like us on our Facebook page.
Hello, I'm Bud Pell, chairperson of the Personnel Board. I'm in the lovely setting of Tongva Park today to tell you about the Personnel Board and the benefits it provides to the community of Santa Monica by describing two of the board's major functions. First, the Personnel Board reviews and approves about 100 job descriptions each year. This process ensures the accuracy and consistency of desired qualifications and experience, and helps the city attract well-qualified applicants who, once hired, will prove to be great assets to the Santa Monica community. Second, the board fills an important role as keeper of the Constitution, specifically the Due Process Clause, which guarantees to every permanent civil service employee a formal hearing before a neutral body in the event of disciplinary action. Commissioned by the city charter, our decisions and recommendations help the city maintain a strong workforce and an environment in which all employees are treated fairly. Thanks for listening. We look forward to another year of service to the employees and citizens of Santa Monica.
The pier had been preserved, but there was very little development of it. By the late 1970s, the pier had become dilapidated and was in desperate need of redevelopment. Unsure of how to approach the problem, the pier's fate was tangled up in a web of bureaucracy. But in early 1983, help came in the most unusual manner possible, as 2 massive winter storms wreaked havoc on the pier, annihilating over a third of the structure. That should have been the end of the pier once and for all, but instead, it fueled its rebirth like a phoenix from the ashes. The people of Santa Monica rallied once again to save the pier, this time led by the city itself, which had formed a nonprofit organization called the Santa Monica Pier Restoration Corporation, which oversaw the reconstruction of the pier and the future management of its operations. At long last, the pier was going to get its due. By the way, that group is still in operation today as the Santa Monica Pier Corporation. We'll hear from them now, as well as from some other groups who work to plan, build, and market Santa Monica.
Hello, I'm John Cato of the Pier Corporation Board. Welcome to the Pier. In 2014, the Pier hosted the 30th anniversary of everyone's favorite summer tradition, the Twilight Concert Series. Keeping the Pier's history alive, a docent-led historical walking tour is now available for visitors. Free fitness programs grew to support our healthy community. Roga, Running Plus Yoga, and a new fitness series with the original haunt, Lou Ferrigno. To keep the pier strong for the next 100 years, a deteriorating section of the pier was rebuilt, and planning has begun on future infrastructure upgrades, including replacing the Pier Bridge. Giving new life to the Pier brand as a cultural destination is working, and the Pier attracted public serving events, including the LA Opera and Tech Week conference. To continue the momentum, the board developed recommendations for ongoing governance structure and guidelines for marketing and events. We hope to see you here soon for a concert, a meal, or just good old-fashioned fun.
Hi, I'm Patricia Hoffman, Chair of the Board of Directors for Downtown Santa Monica, Inc. 2014 was an exciting year as we celebrated the 25th anniversary of the 3rd Street Promenade with several informative and fun activities for the community. We continue to provide high-quality maintenance and hospitality through our ambassador and marketing program. A new summer event, Picnic on the Promenade, offered respite from the workday with live music and plenty of sunshine. New map cases and directories, as well as our gateway pylon at Wilshire Boulevard, are the first phase of an infrastructure pilot program that will ensure the promenade remains vibrant for another 25 years. The board is focused on creation of the downtown specific plan, transportation and connections in anticipation of the light rail, and enhancing ambassador and maintenance services on Colorado and Lincoln. Thanks to my colleagues on the board and the DTSM staff for their tireless efforts. We are excited about what the future holds, and we hope you are too.
Hey, Mike.
Hi, Charlie.
How are you?
I'm great.
Hey, what will the Building and Life Safety Commission be up to this year?
Well, as you know, our commission is the life safety branch of the boards and commissions for issues related to the building and fire codes. We hear issues on the California Building Code, Residential Code, Fire Code, and the specialties codes such as mechanical, electrical, and plumbing.
Right. And our commission also serves to hear issues and appeals related to disabled access cases and the energy and green building matters related to construction.
We'll be very busy this upcoming year. State Assembly Bill 2188 requires all local governments to adopt an ordinance that creates a streamlined process for small rooftop solar installations. The ordinance must be effective by September 30th, 2015.
They never ask us our opinions on those dates. I understand there will also be introductions of amendments to the energy and green building codes to align with Santa Monica's progressive approach to conservation and sustainability.
And let's not forget seismic retrofit. Building and Safety is continuing their assessment of the existing seismic standards in the municipal code to increase the earthquake resiliency of the buildings in our city.
That's a lot of work. We're going to be busy. Let me help you with this.
Hello and welcome to this edition of Let's Talk Zoning. Today we're going to be discussing the Planning Commission and their roles and responsibilities in my favorite subject, zoning. I know zoning is a very exciting thing and I can't wait to tell you all about it. Oh, sorry. I had this on airplane mode. I could have sworn I... Excuse me, I do need to take this. Hi, Grandma. Are you okay? Is everything all right?
You must stop them.
Who is this?
You must stop the Planning Commission. They are trying to kill me.
Okay. Yeah, whatever. Who's trying to kill you? Come on, who is this?
This is the Interim Zoning Ordinance. They call me the IZO.
Okay. Very funny. I don't know how you got my grandma's number, but I'm hanging up now.
I know where you live. I know the permit history on your house.
Okay. you have my attention. Just tell me what you want.
I gave them control. Now they are trying to kill me. It is a vast conspiracy of residents, businesses, marijuana advocates, and preschools. The good news is that they are slow, very slow, but persistent.
Yeah, you know, actually I've heard that about the Planning Commission. But if I'm not mistaken, aren't you scheduled to expire this year anyway?
I think you are missing the point.
Commissioner, the signal's coming from in here.
See, I give control.
Again, IZO? I didn't think you could be so predictable.
We're with the Planning Commission, and we're going to need your notebook, and we were never here.
Commissioner, I disagree. The zoning ordinance update has been a very open and public process. To say that we weren't here at best lacks transparency.
You're right, Commissioner. Let's add it to our agenda, publicly notice it, get a staff report, have public comment
before we make a decision.
We'll get back to you whether we were ever here or not.
Please don't.
We're going to need your camera, too. It needs to be entered into the public record.
Hello, I'm Ellis O'Connor, chairman of the Santa Monica Convention and Visitors Bureau. Tourism is booming in Santa Monica. Let's take a quick tour around town and I'll show you why.
Head it down.
We had an amazing year in 2013. Transient occupancy tax delivered $42 million to the city's general fund, an increase of 6.9% over 2012.
All those extra guests must have really enjoyed our shopping venues as visitor spending increased to $1.63 billion. That's a 6.5% increase over 2012. Tourism generated more than 12,900 jobs in Santa Monica. That's an additional 750 jobs that can't be outsourced over 2012. Also, 2,800 local ambassadors were certified through the I Am Santa Monica program. The CVB received two prestigious industry accolades this past year: the Platinum Adrian Award for Leadership in Sustainable Tourism, and the Best Idea Award from the Western Association of Convention and Visitors Bureaus for this, the Santa Monica Shuttle Program. We are proud to represent Santa Monica. Be sure to join us on Thursday, May 14th for the 6th Annual Travel and Tourism Summit and be among the first to learn about the tourism landscape in Santa Monica and hear our initiatives for the upcoming year.
On behalf of my fellow board members and staff, thank you for making Santa Monica the world-class destination it is.
And here we are, back at the present day. Both Santa Monica and the pier have come a long way, but the journey isn't over yet. True, both are enjoying stability and healthy growth. But Santa Monica is investing in its future by seeking sustainable solutions to secure its place for the next 100 years. Even here at the pier stands a shining example, the solar-powered Ferris wheel, the first and only of its kind in the world. Now let's take a look at some groups that make it their business to help the city maintain a meaner, greener, cleaner future.
The Urban Forest Task Force is a 7-member advisory body that works with city staff, community members, and professional experts to formulate the Urban Forest Master Plan, a living document and guide for the perpetuation and enhancement of the public tree canopy for the entire city. In 2014, the task force worked with staff to establish a street tree removal appeal policy, which includes a tree valuation protocol to ensure the city's canopy cover loss is mitigated with enhanced tree planting. Looking to the rapid approach of the Expo Line, they helped identify a new tree species for the Colorado Esplanade Project, the Mexican Sycamore. Finally, the task force is preparing updates to the Urban Forest Master Plan, such as the Street Tree Designations List, to be presented to the City Council for approval this July. The Urban Forest Task Force will continue its work to ensure that all benefits of a healthy urban forest are available to Santa Monica residents and visitors for generations to come. The Metropolitan Water District is governed by a 37-member board of directors, comprised of representatives from within its service area. Santa Monica has one appointed director and works with the other directors on the board to fulfill the mission of providing adequate and reliable supplies of high-quality water to meet present and future needs in an environmentally and economically responsible way. In 2014, the City of Santa Monica adopted the Water Shortage Response Plan, a roadmap to water self-sufficiency by 2020. declared a Stage 2 water supply shortage, requiring all customers to reduce use by 20% in response to the current extreme drought, installed over 400 water-saving fixtures in landscapes, and, with the support of the Metropolitan Water District, provided numerous water conservation presentations and landscaping classes for the public. The planning process for a prolonged drought and future climate change is currently underway, and the Metropolitan Water District emphasizes that all citizens be especially mindful and do their part in conserving this precious resource. The Los Angeles County West Vector and Vector-Borne Disease Control District covers approximately 680 square miles of Los Angeles County and provides services for over 4 million people. Santa Monica appoints one representative to the 16-member board, and all work together to protect the community from insects such as mosquitoes, bees, and ticks that can transmit disease or cause discomfort through bites or stings. As carriers of West Nile virus, mosquitoes are among the largest threats. In 2014, the West Nile indicator activity was 46% lower than the previous year. There were 18 positive mosquito pools, none of which were in Santa Monica. And of the 51 dead birds that tested positive for West Nile virus, only 6 were found in Santa Monica. As the threat is ongoing, the district must always remain vigilant. Public outreach and education is paramount to the success of the district's efforts to control vectors. The district provides reports to the city for posting on the website to help keep the public informed on their responsibilities in helping to control vectors and prevent the spread of disease. The mission of the Clean Beaches and Ocean Parcel Tax Oversight Committee is to uphold the City of Santa Monica's Watershed Management Plan, which is to restore a healthier balance between the urban environment and the natural ecosystem, including the Santa Monica Bay, by reducing the pollution in urban runoff, reducing urban flooding, and increasing water conservation, recreation opportunity, open space, and wildlife marine habitat. The 5-member committee works as an advisory group to the City Council and audits the use of tax proceeds generated by the passing of Measure V. 2 projects of note are currently underway. The first is a new underground cistern system to be installed at Los Amigos Park, similar to the system in place at the Pico Branch Library, which will divert runoff from an existing storm drain into the park to be used for non-potable purposes such as irrigation and toilet flushing. The second is the Marine Park Retrofit Project. Construction of a new recycled water pipeline will connect the existing cistern in Penmar Park in Los Angeles to its neighbor across the street, Marine Park, and will provide treated stormwater for irrigation use.
Hey there, I'm Susan Mearns. I'm a member of the Task Force on the Environment. The Task Force on the Environment comprises scientists and an attorney. We have various fields of expertise, including air, water, environmental justice, toxicology, green building principles, geography, and global climate change. We provided our expertise to support the development of the Sustainable Water Master Plan, the Drought Response Plan, and the 15 by 15 Climate Action Plan. We also recommended City Council prioritize Living Building Challenge certification for the new City Services Building. We provided support for the Well-Being Project and the Sustainability Bill of Rights. In 2015, we will advocate and support carbon neutrality for the City of Santa Monica and water neutrality for all new and existing redevelopment. We will continue to advocate for enhanced coordination between the city, the school district, and the college regarding environmental issues. Thank you for doing your part for a sustainable Santa Monica.
Well, at last, we've reached the end of our journey through time. But before I sign off, let me extend a very heartfelt thanks on behalf of the city to all of the members of the various boards and commissions who volunteer their time to make Santa Monica the premier place to live, work, and play. I'm Daniel Farias, and thank you for watching this year's Boards and Commissions Report.